You never should have come here. But here you are. You won't last long. Hey, you want to see my head come off?
Disney, Disney, Disney. I can't quite remember the first Disney movie or cartoon I watched as a kid. Snow White, Beauty and the Beast,
so stupid.
Or Pinocchio.
Pinocchio, why didn't you go to school?
I was going to school till I met somebody.
Met somebody?
Yeah, two big monsters with big green eyes.
They were all amazing and still give me this fuzzy feeling when I remember the first time I watched them. But as fairytale-esque as Disney can be, they have a couple of bones in their closet, and the gift from me to you for this Halloween is talking about the top 10 darkest secrets from Disney's past, and hopefully destroying your childhood memories. So, in no particular order, here we go. Walt Disney was an FBI informant. Not many people know that Walt Disney had a special relationship with the then FBI director, J. Edgar Hoover. Due to this friendship, Disney was one of the rare studios which was allowed to film inside the FBI headquarters in Washington. As a return gesture, Disney granted the FBI access to all the Disney parks and film scripts which the FBI used to influence time and time again. Reportedly, Disney even testified against a group of protesting animators before the House Committee at the behest of the FBI.
Some of Disney's most trusted animators were also on the picket line.
I thought this was a unique one to have on the list. It's not particularly scary or anything like that, but it's definitely not something you would expect from, you know, the whole Disney image and all that, so...
Nobody ever does!
Holy shit. Hopefully I don't die before the end of this video. And at number 2, Disney was responsible for lemmings committing suicide. Mass suicide. Disney was responsible for feeding the notion in the minds of people that lemmings often commit mass suicide when their population grows out of control. In case you didn't know what lemmings are, cause I didn't. They are small rodents usually found in or near the Arctic, in tundra biomes. While shooting for a movie called White Wilderness in 1958, Disney clearly used edits and angles to deceive the viewers into thinking that what they were seeing was a natural lemmings migration. However, that's way further from the truth. The closing shot of the film shows a lake filled with dead bodies of lemmings, but in reality, the lemmings did not jump on their own. So, what do you think happened? Disney is responsible for it. They were pushed by the Disney film crew.
You're a monster!
At number 3, we have abandoned parks.
We've all been abandoned.
Some Disney parks have been abandoned without any clear explanation, with the most controversial one being the River Country, Disney's first water park. While Disney maintains that River Country was closed down because of dwindling footfall, the reality is pretty shocking. In 2001, Nick Galerio Fowleri, I don't know if I'm pronouncing that right, but that is a brain-eating amoeba that was discovered in the lake surrounding River Country. This lake was the major source of water for all the water slides. Therefore, some sources argue that the park was closed because of this amoeba that directly attacks the human brain. What is even more intriguing is that a guest died in 1980 because of the same amoeba, but even then, the River Country Park remained functional and was only closed down more than 20 years later in 2001.
Disney closed the park due to a deadly brain-eating bacteria in the water. This is sort of true, as in 1980, an 11-year-old boy died after swimming in River Country. This brain-eating amoeba is called Nagliria florei and can be found in warm bodies of water across the world. There really wasn't and still isn't a treatment for such a case, mostly because contracting it is extremely rare, and only happens typically in lakes, which half of river country essentially was.
At number 4, we have the mysterious death of Debbie Stone. An 18-year-old Debbie Stone was a hostess on the ride America Sings at Disneyland, California, and her job was to bid farewell to the living audience. But only 9 days later, Debbie's body was found mysteriously crushed between a rotating wall and a stationary one. Some members of the audience admitted to hearing screams from the backstage, but ignored them, thinking all was just part of the performance, I guess. Till this date, the mystery of her death has not been properly solved. What do you think happened?
No one knows exactly what went wrong on that fateful night, but there has been a few theories. She may have tripped, taken a step backwards, or attempted to leap from one stage to the next. But one thing was clear, Debbie was dead, and died a quick but agonizing death.
At number 5, Disney Island reports numerous incidents of people spilling ashes of their loved ones in the parks.
Passionate Disney fans are taking their love for the theme park to a whole new level. They're choosing to have their ashes scattered in the happiest place on Earth.
Since the 1990s, there have been numerous incidents where people have been caught spreading the ashes of their loved ones throughout Disney's theme parks. This occurrence has become so common that Disney has trained dedicated staff just to handle such occurrences. This crew uses sophisticated vacuum cleaners to remove the ash particles from the air and prevent them from entering the lungs of the tourists. Next time you go to a Disney park, you're probably just walking on dead people, basically, and breathing in dead people. That's funny. At number 6, we have Nancy Disney. Not much is more disturbing than the Nazis or Nazism. And even more disturbing is that, in the height of the Nazi Germany's decision to action a final solution to the Jewish problem, even Disney was engaging in Nazism. 1942 marks the release of Disney's short animated film titled, I'm not going to try to pronounce that. The film follows Donald Duck, who is working as a soldier dealing with Nazi food rations and enduring a rather laborious job in an artillery factory. Though the film was one in a long line of propaganda films released by the Walt Disney Company, it is often cited by fans as one of the darker moments in Disney's history because of its depiction of Donald Duck as a Nazi, though a reluctant one. Interestingly, it even scored itself an Academy Award, but was not publicly released into the general market due to its controversial subject matter. Disney is also claimed to have engaged in Nazism in 1994 with the release of The Lion King. The scene in the film where Scar has his moments in the musical limelight for his number Be Prepared is rumored to be directly inspired by the footage from a 1935 Nazi propaganda film titled Triumph of the Will. The hyenas depicted in the scene represents Nazi soldiers, while Scar, who is seated at the top of a cliff, is said to represent Adolf Hitler, standing on the podium overlooking his troops. If you know anything about Nazi war and German history, this is pretty dark, especially we're talking about Disney here. So that still even gets in the mud with something like that, that's pretty bad. And at number 7, we have the motherless hero tradition. If I asked you to tell me how many of Disney's main characters have a mother and father, you'd probably be left thinking for a while. And I wouldn't blame you, because Disney has a history of storytelling of just, for some reason, having fatherless characters. Ever thought it was a bit odd how many central Disney characters don't have a mother? Jasmine in Aladdin, Belle in Beauty and the Beast, even Little Nemo was brought up by his dad. Some conspiracy theories have suggested that this could be the result of a secret Disney agenda to spread anti-family values among the younger generations, but the real reason behind this is actually less sinister and incredibly sad. In 1938, following the success of Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs, Walt Disney and his brother Roy presented their parents with a new house in North Hollywood. Walt's mother, Flora Disney, complained of problems with the gas furnace in their new home. Although repairmen visited the house, it wasn't properly fixed. Just a few months later, after moving into the house, Flora died of asphyxiation caused by the fumes from the faulty furnace. She was only 17. Disney therefore regularly refused to include mother figures in his movies as a somber reflection on his guilt over her death. At number 8, we have the original story of Mulan. It's a short one, but it's quite interesting. It's very likely that you are familiar with Disney's Mulan. This renewed animated movie from Disney was inspired by the story of a Chinese warrior woman named Hua Mulan. Her story was described in the Ballad of Mulan that was written by some anonymous poet somewhere between 386 to 534 AD. Interestingly, the original story of Mulan doesn't match the one we see in the Disney's Mulan. That's nothing new, as is with most adaptations of, you know, the lore that Disney has adapted over the years. But this is quite interesting because in the novel, we see that the original Mulan returns to her homeland, but after reaching there, she finds out that her father has died a long time ago, and her mother actually remarried another man. And seeing all these unfortunate incidents, Mulan couldn't take it anymore, and guess what? Committed suicide. That's a pretty dark ending for something that ends up being adapted to the romantic ending we see in Disney's Mulan. At number 9, we have Disney and sexism.
You've got it, sweet cakes. No more talking, singing, zip.
But without my voice, how can I?
You'll have your looks, your pretty face, and don't underestimate the import.
Accusations of Disney movies providing sexist portrayals of women have haunted the company for many decades. The Disney princesses in particular have generated criticism for their unachievable tiny waist and bizarrely emphasized eyes, the latter of which are usually wider than the former. It's worrying to think what ramifications such depictions could have on young, impressionable girls. In 2016, Ellie Taylor, a teenager from Birmingham in England, overcame a battle with anorexia that had lasted for years, which she claimed had been motivated by a desire to be like a Disney princess. But it's not just the way the female Disney characters look. Linguist Carmen Fott and Karen Eisenhower recently unmasked a concerning trend within the dialogue of Disney movies. The linguist revealed that even in films where female characters are supposedly the central figures, they're given far fewer lines than their male co-stars. In Pocahontas, females speak only 24% of the lines, in Mulan, 23% of the lines, and despite it supposedly being a story about two sisters, the women of Frozen are given only 40% of the lines. Warmer than I thought. What is that? At number 10, we have mass slaughter in Beauty and the Beast. The entire basis of the movie is Bella falling in love with her captor. We all gloss over this small fact when we talk about how romantic the film is and all that. One of the dark Disney things the Beast does is letting Gaston and his cronies attack the castle just because he's sad, putting the lives of his entire staff at risk. But even darker than that.
Now!
Another thing I heard mentioned in the past but never really thought much about, at least not until making this video, is a scene where there are a lot of broken furniture in a dark room where the Beast warns nobody should go into. Well, the logic goes something like this. If pretty much everyone in the castle was put on a spell to turn to some furniture, a fixture of some sort, does that mean those broken furnitures are people Beast had killed in one of his outbursts or outrages? And if so, that's pretty dark. They basically showed you a mass murder scene, but in cartoon style. Anyway, if you enjoyed the video, like, subscribe, and if you want me to do more top 10 stuff like this, Let me know down in the comments and tell me which one of these was most shocking to you. And this is my gift to you for this Halloween. So what's your gift to me? You could please like, share, and all that magic. That's the greatest gift I could ask for. And don't forget to subscribe. That said, see you guys later.